Tonight on Joy News Prime, thousands of private teachers who have been out of jobs for months as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic to hold funerals across the country over what they say has been government refusal to come to their aid.
We must not sit to mourn crocodile tears at the funeral of our famished workers. They do not need garlands on their graves or beautiful tributes and eulogies by their coffins.
Joy News obtains copy of a report by Ghana Institute of Surveyors on the Saglemi housing project, which the Works and Housing Minister says shows embezzlement of more than $100 million.
How would you say there is an embezzlement of $104 million without somebody signing that the one who's not done the work should be paid?
Politicians from across the divide pay tribute to murdered Infantiman MP Eko Kwanza Hayford at the one-week commemoration of his death.
Whether it's armed robbery or not, we will do what we have to investigate the matter thoroughly.
It's a call to all us, the leaders, to make sure that our people are safer, because this is something that Ghanaians face every day.
In business,
Africa Continental featured agreement to restore 30 million jobs lost to COVID-19.
Trade response to COVID-19, we provided proposals to heads of states and to ministers of trade that trade corridors should be established during the period of the pandemic.
Charles Aite will be here with the business in about 30 minutes. My name is Israel Lai, and Joy News Prime is coming to you live from our Final Fast studios at Kokomilimili here in Accra on your digital terrestrial TV, because we are free to air and on DSTV channel 421 and GoTV channel 144. Do stay tuned in. Thousands of private teachers who have been out of jobs since schools were shut down by government to control the spread of COVID-19 have resolved to don funeral clothes for the next 2 weeks to draw attention to their plight. The teachers, numbering over 16,000, according to the Ghana National Association of Private Schools, were told to stay at home as there were no students to be taught. Unlike their counterparts in public schools who have continued to receive their salaries while at home, the affected teachers say they have not been paid since April and are really struggling to survive. At a news conference in Accra Thursday, the association said its members will hold funerals across the country if government refuses to come to their aid. There's more in this report by Kweku Esante.
She was a 24-year-old lady nursing a six-month-old baby. On 16th March 2020, the private school where she taught class 3 pupils was closed down in response to government's directive on the closure of schools throughout the country. She returned home crestfallen to her husband, who had just completed one of the tertiary institutions in the country and was yet to secure a job. With no means of subsistence, how was she to cater for her first daughter and unemployed husband?
This is what private teachers are going through across the length and breadth of the country. This is according to the Ghana National Association of Private Schools. According to acting president of the association, Dr. Damasus Turosong, their members have not received any salary for more than 6 months following the closure of schools as a precaution to the outbreak of coronavirus in Ghana. The association is therefore calling on government to come to its aid and save them from starvation.
We are here this morning to once again draw government's attention to the plight of our workers and implore government to immediately come to the aid of private school workers. We must not sit to mourn crocodile tears at the funeral of our famished workers. They do not need garlands on their graves or beautiful tributes and eulogies by their coffins. We must act now to save them from starvation.
The association is also directing private school teachers across the country to wear funeral outfits for 2 weeks if government fails to heed to calls to come to their aid.
I hereby announce that from Monday, 19th October 2020, all private school managers and workers are to begin wearing funeral outfits. If government fails to come to the assistance of our teachers within the 2-week period, the full-blown funeral ceremonies will commence from Monday, 2nd November 2020. A series of activities will be carried out from then onwards to mourn with our teachers and workers. To this end, funeral rites will be organized across the 16 regions of Ghana to mourn the plight of our emaciated, starving workers.
Courage Kekeli, a private school teacher, noted that life has been unbearable for him and other colleagues since government closed schools some 7 months ago.
In fact, some of us, especially we, the private school teachers, things are very difficult. Things are so tough for some of us. I'm a 40-year-old man with a wife and children. I also look after my extended family, and I have to, you know, take good care of my children as well. As a teacher, as I do take care of other people's children, I have to do the same for my children. And, you know, for now, we the private school teachers, most of us, we are jobless, especially those who don't have any other work apart from teaching, and I'm part of them. Things are so difficult and tough for us.
Now, Joy News has obtained a copy of an assessment report conducted by the Ghana Institute of Surveyors showing the value of the Tagleme housing units falls way below the $179.9 million said to have been paid for it. The report is the basis for a claim of embezzlement by Works and Housing Minister Samuel Atachia when he appeared on PM Express last night. He argues that the difference between the valuation of the housing units at the site by the Ghana Institute of Surveyors of $64 million and the nearly $180 million paid the contractor could only have been embezzled.
How can that be? Because at the end of the day, I'm saying that, how would you say there is an embezzlement of $104 million without somebody signing that the one who's not done the work should be paid?
Mr. Collins Dowder was a minister at the time.
Yes. Has
he been spoken to?
He's been invited. And that is something that I didn't want to go into that because I don't want to make politics out of it. But I'm saying that.
He's invited when? Recently or a year ago?
He's been invited at the beginning of the year.
This year?
Yes, sir.
Did he honor the invitation?
He had no choice.
CID did invite him?
Yes, he was invited.
So, and what was the outcome of the investigation?
They are processing the whole issues.
And he hasn't been charged?
I'm not sure he's been charged because at the end of the day, they want to do a thorough job. It's very, very, very interesting for you to know that I don't believe in witch hunting. But when the arithmetic is clear, let's leave them to do it. But I'm saying that I have conclusive evidence that the defalcation is in the sum of $104 million all the United States dollars. You measure the houses on the ground. That is why it lies ill in your mouth to talk about NDC, MPP, not ruling a house. If you had the benefit of even 2 million, 200 million United States dollars anywhere to do any housing, without saying that this is revolving. Mm-hmm. And that is how messy the whole thing is.
Tomorrow, with the greatest of respect, I'll do you the honors of delivering to you a copy of the report by the Ghana Institute.
And give me a copy as well.
I can give you a copy for your charge. That is an honor that I owe this studio. Because
yes.
I hold you people in high esteem, and I'm not here to do propaganda.
Okay.
That at my level, I'm beginning to say that no measurement has been done. But for purposes of showing that some people have messed up this country.
The Ghana Institute of Surveyors has confirmed conducting the assessment but would not speak to claims of embezzlement by the minister. So what's contained in the report, which the minister promised and delivered a copy to Joy News. Parliamentary correspondent Joseph Opoku-Gakpo has been going through the report and joins me via Zoom with more. Now, Joseph, I recall you had that interview with the Works and Housing Minister when he first stated that Collins Dowder had been invited by the police over the matter. What are some of the discoveries made by the Ghana Institute of Surveyors to support this claim of embezzlement? All right, we are having some challenges with Joseph, but we'll get to resolve that very soon. But the minority spokesperson on works and housing has also been speaking on the matter. Emmanuel Kwesi Bedra, who has was on the same show, questioned the authenticity of the report.
Institutional Survey, not just an honorary member. I'm a fellow of the Ghana Institute of Surveyors. I'm not just a surveyor, I'm a quantity surveyor by profession. And I belong to a political party. I will not sit in parliament as a member of the Western Housing Committee. Then we'll with all the assessment, and then somebody else will say that we have been shortchanged by this by the contractor or by the former administration. Now he says that the institution has given him some measurement, has given him some costing. He has not made it available to the minority. We have trumpeted this, we have said it over. I took journalists to the side, said that if there is anything that anybody has done, we want evidence. He has brought some evidences. He said he has sent all those evidences to the Attorney General for advice. Till today, today the Ghana Institution of Surveyors or the Ghana Institution of Survey is on the block now. You are telling us that my institution has gone there to do measurement. I'll cross-check.
Sure.
And Evans, I want you to cross-check. I'll give you the name of the president and the chairman of my division to be sure whether the institution has gone there to do any measurement. Because the then MD of AESL was a fellow of Ghana Institution of Surveyors. He was a quant surveyor. The late Alhaji Masoud Musa. Masoud Musa will not supervise a job that is expensive, that will go beyond what is supposed to, to be given. So for this one, I don't want to take it. I want Joy FM to go
tomorrow. Tomorrow, with the greatest of respect, I'll do you the honors of delivering to you a copy of the report by the Ghana Institute.
And give me a copy as well.
I can give you a copy for your charge. That is an honor that I owe this studio. Because I hold you people in high esteem, and I'm not here to do propaganda.
All right. I already indicated we have obtained a copy of that report, and the Ghana Institute of Surveyors has also confirmed conducting the assessment of that work, but will not speak to claims of embezzlement by the Minister. Parliamentary Correspondent Joseph Opoku-Gakwa has indicated it has joined us. Now, Joseph, I recall you had that interview with the Works and Housing Minister when he first stated that Collins Dauda had been invited by the police over the matter. What are some of the discoveries made by the Ghana Institute of Surveyors to support this claim of embezzlement, as you have the report with you right now?
Looks like now we're getting more details of the specific concerns as far as this particular project is concerned, even after that conversation with the minister about a week ago. So the report makes the point that the parliament actually approved an amount of $200 million US dollars for this particular project. Out of that, an amount of $196 million was actually disbursed to the contractor for the construction of 1,506 units as far as the houses at Saglimi are concerned. But according to Mr. Samuel Atatia, particularly the said report coming from the Ghana Institution of Engineers, so far the completed project amounts to 668 units, and the cost per the backing costing that has been done by the institution amounts to $64.9 million US dollars. So instead of $200 million, there's a situation where when the valuation was done of the project in question, it was found that it cost to the tune of $64 million, meaning more than 144 million cedis is the amount that's outstanding, which, according to the minister, was embezzled by the contractor and some officials in the former administration.
All right. Thank you very much, Joseph Opoku-Gakpo, bringing us some details from that report by the Ghana Institute of Surveyors. Moving on, the Northeast Region Police has arrested an officer accused of facilitating the illegal acquisition of a gun license for a suspected thief undergoing trial at the Nalarugu District Court. Inspector Felix Bekle, who formerly worked with the former police unit, is alleged to have taken pictures of the gun being held by prosecutors as an exhibit in court and used his colleagues within the service to create a gun license for the alleged thief standing trial for possessing the same gun without license. Northeast Regional Correspondent Elias Otanko has been speaking with the police commander and has come through with the following report.
Inspector Beckley, who is now with the Nalarugu Police,
was arrested and interrogated last month at the Northeast Regional Police Command, where he admitted to helping the suspect to procure the lances. He only sent a picture of the gun to a colleague at the Form Police Unit of the Tesano Divisional Police Command, where he worked previously, to facilitate the process. Joy News learned the suspect Adam Musa was arrested in August this year for allegedly stealing. Police subsequently found an unregistered pump action gun in his house during investigations. Adam was arrested and charged with possessing an unlicensed firearm and stealing, as he was put before the Nalirgu District Court. As the trial progressed, however, the suspect managed to produce a lances prepared by the Tesono Divisional Police for his gun. Police prosecutors, who became suspicious, prayed to the court for more time to examine the lances, which turned out to have been dubiously procured with the help of Police Inspector Beckley. DCOP Kweju Entwitabi is the Northeast Regional Police Commander, who first explained how the officer was arrested.
Our primary investigations revealed that photographs of the weapon was taken in the charge office, Nalirgu Police Station charge office, and sent to Accra. We realized that the document indicated that it was issued by the Tesano Police, that is the license of the weapon. It was licensed at Tesano Police. And we're wondering how it could be licensed when the weapon at that time was in the custody of the police. So a preliminary investigation was led to that place, and we found out, it was revealed to us that Inspector Beckley took the photographs, sent to his colleague also at Accra in one of the police formations, FPU. And he is the one who sent the photograph of the gun bearing the serial number of the gun to the Tesano Police Arms and Ammunition Section to be registered. So when I got the information, I asked that they escort the inspector to my office for interrogation in the presence of the Deputy Regional Police Commander, Assistant Commissioner of Police, Mr. Ali, and the Regional Crown Officer Superintendent, Mr. Duga. Upon interrogation, initially he denied, but later when I confronted him that, looking at the photograph, it was taken at a charge office where he is a station officer, and that he took the photographs. Then he admitted.
Residents in the area have always accused the police of helping suspected criminals to escape justice. The action, which has resulted in a widespread suspicion against the criminal justice system here, has also often led to the execution of what is being termed as jungle justice by aggrieved parties. The regional commander, however, said the police officer will be prosecuted, as he has already been charged with abetment.
Under miscreants in the police service to stop aiding criminals, because it is our mandate to provide security to ensure that criminals in the system are arrested and dealt with. And so if because of money you are going to assist a criminal, then this is not your. They will be found out, and so the earlier you stop, the better.
Elias Sutanko reporting for Joy News.
Hundreds of Nigerian traders Thursday marched up at the premises of the Nigerian High Commission in protest of what they call inhumane treatment meted out to them by the government of Ghana. Section 27, subsection 1 of the GIPC Act 865 bars foreigners from partaking in retail trade in Ghana. Against this backdrop, local authorities have on multiple occasions moved in to shut down operations of businesses which they believed were flouting this directive. But today, the traders, some of whose shops have been closed since December 2019, say they are dying of hunger and want to be evacuated back to Nigeria if the Ghanaian authorities will not allow them to reopen their shops. Manuel Kurante, what's at the Nigerian High Commission in our reports?
The members of the Nigerian Traders Association of Ghana have today massed up in front of the Nigerian High Commission, and their requests are two. First of all, that the commission facilitates the reopening, the immediate reopening, by that I mean of their shops, some of which have been locked since December 2019. They want the shops to be opened, or at least they be evacuated back to their home country, Nigeria.
I'm assuring you, by end of this month, if they not evacuate us, we will charter bus and go and keep ourselves in the border, because we show them that we really want to go. So I can't be taking information of dead person because of one thing or the other. That is not my calling. And we are now being subjected to a hardship that are causing our lives. And we thought the best thing to do is to come here to ask you to do whatever in your power, and you also to inform our government, of course, which we all know that you have been doing.
Meanwhile, Nigeria's acting High Commissioner to Ghana, Esther Ariwa, who received the petition, assured of the Nigerian government's commitment to handling the situation.
But I want to know that the Nigerian government too is not resting on your case. Just as you mentioned, it's because of you, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, His Excellency Bajabi Amila, came to Ghana. Likewise, the VP was here, and out of his busy schedule, he said he would like to meet with the executives of the the NUTAG. News that you people will be coming this morning. I had to also make a call fast that, our people are coming. And the information I got is that, yes, it's up there at the presidency. So we are hoping very soon your situation will be addressed.
Let me speak to this man here. Boss, you've come here, but we've heard the Nigerian government say that it's in talks with the Ghanaian government, and that should assure you to some extent?
That is diplomacy, and we know diplomacy, if we like, what it entails. Yes, they have assured us that, the matter is being settled at the top level, but we actually do not know as and when the matter will be resolved at the top. And you can see the citizens here, everybody is disappointed, dejected, and some people go home, not knowing where the next meal will come from.
Supposed to be here. It is over 11, going to 11 months now, he shut down somebody's shop where he feed his children from, his family. These men that's gathered here, they have children. Some of them are married to Ghanaian ladies also. Now, where you have locked their shop for 10 good months, if they are beginning to become armed robbers, you will say our Nigerians are bad, but still they humble themselves and couple themselves for now, for these 10 months, nothing has been done. It's not fair. We want the shop to be open.
But we are all ECOWAS citizens, so the Ghanaian law cannot supersede the ECOWAS law. So what my take is, hence we are ECOWAS citizens, we are all the same in the same sub-region, so the shops should be open for us because we are one people, we are not foreigners in Ghana.
Are you not breaching Ghanaian laws, as they say?
Yeah, it's their law. It's their law. But we are pleading. At least let the law also look human being face. Do you get me? Uh-huh. I know that it's their law, but we are also pleading that they will give us a little time, because we have families. As you see me here, I have a family, I have young ones with me here. And since then, how we are moving, eating, is only God.
To open the land borders for them to move, if their shops are not going to be open for them to begin proper operations. They want to pick their stuff, pack their baggages and move out. Alternatively, the government should help them get evacuated back to their home country. From here at the Nigerian High Commission, my name is Manuel Quanting for Joy News.
The Tanzania 2422 the second has expressed worry about the proliferation of weapons in the country ahead of elections. He warns that proliferation could be interpreted as the people having lost trust in the police. The widespread of small arms has become a threat to security as the general elections draw near. Otunfo said this when the IGP, James Opongbuenu, paid a courtesy call on him ahead of a police simulation exercise for election 2020. Now, Jima has more in the following report.
A research conducted by the Kofi Annan International Peacekeeping Training Center in 2014 revealed 2.3 million small arms are in civilian hands, with 1.1 million of them unregistered. Police records show only 100,000 of licenses for these registered arms are renewed annually. Otumfuo Osei-Tutu is charging the police to deal with the proliferation of arms in the country. I read yesterday that there are a lot of small arms in the country. Why is that so? If it has gotten to a point that civilians are purchasing small arms for themselves, then it means the people do not trust you, the police. You will have to consider that critically to ensure that this election is peaceful. The occupant of the golden stool also wants police to thoroughly investigate recent issues of insecurity in the country, especially highway robberies. He believes the ability of the police to handle such issues will contribute to peaceful elections. There have been increase in highway robberies recently. Even members of parliament have become targets, with one losing his life to a highway robbery. You have been trained to investigate such matters. I entreat you to investigate all the issues. It is towards ensuring peace in the upcoming elections. The IGP, James Opombuenu, after witnessing a simulation exercise by the police, assured the public of heightened security throughout the election period.
What I'm saying that before, during, and after the elections, we are prepared to deal with any situation that comes. We have seen the simulation, we have seen the patrols in the night, the patrols in the day. So whatever happens, we are prepared to deal with it. You know, we had the registration, and the registration gave us an insight as to which places we need to beef up security, which places we need to observe. So after the registration, we have gone back to the drawing board and identified several hotspots that we are going to beef up security with at.
These young men and women who have
tried. From Kumasi for Joy News, Nana Ajima reporting.
You're watching Joy News Prime. We're taking a break, but still ahead in the bulletin. Politicians from across the divide pay tribute to slain Infantiman MP Akko Kwanza Hayford at the 1 week commemoration of his death.
Whether it's armed robbery or not, we will do what we have to investigate the matter thoroughly.
It's a call to all us, the leaders, to make sure that our people are safer, because this is something that Ghanaians face every day.
Then in business, Africa Continental Free Trade Agreement to restore over 30 million jobs lost to COVID-19. That comes up after the break. Stay tuned.
Good evening. It's now time for business. I'm Charles Aitim. The Director General of the Africa Continental Free Trade Agreement area, Wamkele Mena, says the APTA will be the growth pole for reviving the African economy. Figures from the World Bank show that 25 to 30 million jobs in Africa got lost to the coronavirus. Speaking at an engagement with the diplomatic community from Africa member states in Accra, Wamkele Mena stated that all loose ends to the agreement are being firmed up to make it a viable one in 2021.
COVID-19 has been a delaying factor in the start of trading, because out of 55 countries, 42 were either in a full or partial lockdown. Borders were closed, goods were not transiting, so we had to take account of this reality. Hence, we now have a new date of 1st of January 2021. We had, as a trade response to COVID-19, we provided advice, proposals to heads of states and to ministers of trade that trade corridors should be established during the period of the pandemic. And second, that for the goods that are required for fighting the pandemic, that are essential for fighting the pandemic, that these goods should be allowed to transit through borders at zero rates without any duties, so that millions and millions of Africans can have access to these products. This is the these are the proposals that we made as a secretariat, as part of the arsenal of the African Union of fighting COVID-19.
Now, scheduled domestic air flights resumed fully today despite an earlier warning of a full-blown strike by workers of the Ghana Civil Aviation Authority. The site, the strike, the sit-down strike yesterday, briefly disrupted some flights from the Kotoka International Airport. But joint business operations were normal. We're getting that from domestic carriers, one of which is Africa World Airlines, which says that passengers experienced seamless flights today. Chief Operations Officer of AWA, Sean Mendes, says 16 flights have so far been successful.
We've had no issues with our operations today. In fact, all of our flights have run perfectly on time. Following yesterday's disruptions, today we've had 7 Kumasi flights, 4 Tamale flights, 2 Takoradi flights, one each to Lagos, Abuja, and Abidjan, and all of these flights have operated on time with no disruptions. There's another Lagos flight planned tonight, which will also be on schedule. So today's operations are perfectly back to normal.
Well, let's now turn our attention to Wutria Lotteries, where a teacher walked home with 20,000 cedis in the weekly draw.
The lottery company that operates through Star 787 Hash has awarded 20,000 Ghana cedis to a primary teacher, JC Ernest.
So I was very excited. In fact, I didn't expect this to happen to me, so by God's grace.
Richard Akutu Banfo, the head of customer experience, also admonished all Ghanaians to be part of Star 787 Hash Lottery to win in this Thursday's jackpot.
This Thursday, packed with a 1,000 Ghana cedis prize, you stand the chance to win 302,000 Ghana cedis this Saturday.
And that'll be all for business. I'm Charles Aite. Sports is up next.
Thank you for staying with us on Journeys Prime. Gary here with the sport. Now, first story, Godwin Marty has accused Asamoah and his brother Bafo of assaulting him during a tennis match. The computer consultant says the incident is said to have occurred at a 37 Army officers' mess last night.
Bafo just shouted from the umpire chair that, "My friend, shut up and stand there and play. Shut up and play," in a very aggressive tone. I was surprised because I wasn't even speaking out of any tone of provocation. I was just making my point clear that I would like us to have a proper match. Then he continued to shout. So I told him that the way he's shouting is intimidating me, and I will lose focus even if I have to play. And tennis is a game of focus. So you know what? I will not play again. Let me just kindly, respectfully sit down. Then next time we can play a game. Then I sat down. He was insisting I should go stand there and play. Then he came down from the upper chair and came to hit me. That my friend, go there. I said, go there, go and play. He was hitting me to go and play. Everything was like a movie to me. I was so surprised. Then as he was hitting me, Asamoah now came. He was hitting me and people came to hold Bafo. That my friend stopped, that he should not hit me. They were trying to push him away. Then before Asamoah came, actually, I was telling him that the way you are hitting me, I'll report this to the police. He said, you can go anywhere. I don't care. If you like, go to the police. They can't do anything. Yeah, in this country, they can't do anything. He says bragging and talking. Then when he moved away a bit, because people were holding him and dragging him away, Asamoah came by because he was my opponent. He also came in support of what Bafo was already doing, assaulting me. Then I even was even telling him, if you listen to the audio, you have the full audio, because somehow I got the wisdom to quickly start recording, because I was actually under threat. I was very, very afraid because nobody knew me there, and it looked like nobody was able to challenge them. It appeared to me that they were like the lords of that court. Everybody was intimidated. So I was alone, and anything could happen. So I can't go Facebook Live because they will see it, obviously, and they may even collect the phone and smash it and beat me more. So I just found a slight opportunity to quickly go on my phone, quickly went to my call recorder app and started recording. So they didn't know that I was recording. But it was a public situation. Everybody was there, and there was chaos. Then someone just came, and I was telling him that, you see, Bafo just came and slapped me and beat me. He said, hey, you deserve it. And if you do, he will beat you more. You deserve it. He went on and on like that, and it was a mess. I was shocked. Bafo Jan now came back again, that if I talk again, he will beat me again.
In a response, Bafo Jan has spoken to a Kumasi-based station, Pure FM, and he has denied the allegations and said that he was being set up, he and his brother. Moving on, chairman of the local organizing committee for the 2023 Africa Games has called on federations to throw their weight behind his team to make the preparations and organization of the games a success. But for the moment, Gary L. Smith, thank you for your time.